Thank you. Thank you. Good morning and welcome to this, our Easter Sunday service. If you're here on this very special day of the church calendar for the first time, then my name is Ali.
And I'm Kate.
And we'll be guiding you through our full feature-packed service this morning. It's a privilege to be streaming live across social media as we're focused on the good news, the greatest news known to humankind, the death, burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Amen to that. And over the next few minutes, we are so excited to be able to feature some of our kids and youth at The Rock. Taking our services online has meant we've had to look at every aspect and adjust certain things for our digital audience. Our kids' work has been happening separately to these live streams, but we're so happy to say that today we're able to feature some of them right now, right at the start of our service.
That's right. And we're going to start right away with our regular members updates. Normally, we show you some pictures of our adults, but today we're going to switch to the younger members amongst us. So first up, here's Rosie filling her back garden with bubbles.
Next up, we have Myla and Max having some fun in the hot tub.
Over to Keyworth, and we have Ben out on a ride with his mum on her new bike.
And back at home, we have Becca baking some mouth-watering cakes with Granny.
And if that wasn't exciting enough, there were both up for half an hour's exercise with Joe Wicks.
Good old Joe Wicks. And here we see Radley modelling his new look, Lockdown Mohican, looking very cool there, Radley.
And finally, we have Dylan, Ted and Rex on their daily walk. I'm not sure whether Becky dressed them in a traffic light sequence on purpose or not, but looking great. Either way.
Oh, it is so great to see our kids, isn't it? And we just miss you all so much.
Absolutely, we do. But it doesn't end there, because we got hold of a few more of our younger people during this week as we wanted to hear in their own words what their highs and lows were of lockdown. And also in the run-up to today, we wanted to hear some of their thoughts about Easter. So here's what they had to say.
The best thing about the lockdown is the fact that I can spend more time with my family.
Being able to sleep in the morning.
I think I get to see my family much more.
I can still talk to my friends on my phone.
The best thing about lockdown is being off school.
Spending time with my family.
The best thing of lockdown is that I get to play lots with Mummy.
Seeing Granny.
Getting to stay with you.
Being here together.
That I'm allowed to ride my bike and go out.
Playing with Lego, watching TV and creating stuff with my Lego and building stuff and playing with my Barbies drawing.
The worst thing about the lockdown is the fact I can't go to school anymore for the next couple of months.
Not being able to go to dancing and see my friends.
I don't get to see my friends.
That I can't play football with my friends.
The worst thing about lockdown is that I can't go to the barbers and get a haircut.
I don't get to see my school friends.
The worst thing about lockdown is I don't get to see my friends.
Not seeing action.
To go to the park.
Seeing my best friends.
That I have to do maths at home.
I can't see my friends.
Because we get to remember that Jesus died for us. The best thing about Easter that Jesus died and then came alive.
It's when Jesus came back to life.
That Jesus died on the cross for us.
Easter is special to me because Jesus made a way for us to make it to heaven.
For me, the thing that's special about Easter is the day that Jesus arose from the dead after being crucified on the cross for our sins.
That's when God came back to life.
Because I get chocolate and Easter eggs.
Finding chocolate.
Eating chocolate.
Elephants.
Watch, it's because of Easter, then you get loads of chocolate.
Do you like chocolate?
Yeah.
How much?
150 chocolates.
Oh. Does Rex not like Easter eggs?
I have any chocolate eggs.
You don't have any chocolate eggs? Oh, can you say Happy Easter?
So good to see some more of our kids there. You all seem to be doing great, and hopefully you're not testing your parents too much. Now, kids, don't run off, but stick around at least a few minutes longer, because we've got something special for you as well as our adults to watch right now. The story of Easter is absolutely central to the Christian message. Without the birth of Christ, there will be no death. And without death, there will be no burial. Without burial, there will be no resurrection. And without resurrection, we will be left stuck with the consequences of our sins. That means heading for hell rather than heaven. That's why the Easter message is crucial to the Christian faith, whatever time of the year it is. Now, we wanted to capture this story in a creative way, and we're going to do that right now in the next 5-minute clip, as told by children. So, whether you're young or old, sit back and relax as we capture the brilliance of the good news of Jesus Christ.
Hello! We want to tell you an amazing story.
It's about God.
He loves us so much, he sent his son Jesus to us, so we can be friends with God.
This is our story of Easter.
Jesus is really cool.
Jesus looked after people.
He did some incredible miracles.
He's basically like Superman, but he's dressed in different clothes.
Jesus said he was a way for everyone to be friends with God, and some people didn't like that.
One day, Jesus went to Jerusalem
and got his friends together for a special supper.
Jesus even washed his friends' stinky feet
and taught them something important:
that we should love each other
the same way he loves us.
Jesus said, "Eat this bread and wine and remember me."
And they sang their favourite song.
Later on, Jesus went to a garden to pray.
His friends went too, but they fell asleep. Jesus prayed and talked with God, his Father in heaven. They had a plan together to save all the people in the world.
Then suddenly, soldiers came to arrest Jesus and took him away.
His friends were afraid and ran off.
The leaders asked Jesus, "Are you the Son of God?" And Jesus said, "Yes."
The leaders didn't like that.
The soldiers hurt Jesus and made fun of him.
And they gave him a little hat, was like spiky to hurt his head. And they gave him a big heavy cross to carry.
And they pinned him up on his hands and feet.
Some people shouted at Jesus,
"If you really are God's son, then just climb down."
Jesus could have climbed down. He could have made it stop, but he stayed there. Because he loves us, it was all part of the plan.
Then Jesus died.
And Mary and everyone cried.
The sky got really dark. The sun couldn't shine.
Maybe because the badness was all in it, making God feel sad.
They put Jesus' body in a tomb.
And they pushed a huge stone in front of the door so no one could get in.
3 days later, God sent an angel from heaven. When the soldiers saw the angel, they got scared and ran off.
the angel rolled the stone away.
Then some of Jesus' friends came to the tomb to wash Jesus' body, but the tomb was empty.
And they saw the shining angel who told them,
"Don't be afraid, Jesus is not here. He is not dead anymore. Jesus is alive again."
The friends rushed home to tell everybody.
But Mary stayed a bit longer. She thought the gardener was coming to talk to her.
But it was Jesus.
A few days later, Jesus' friends were all together having dinner. And then Jesus appeared to them. They were a bit scared at first, and then they got very excited. And Jesus explained the plan, that now nothing, not even really bad stuff, can separate us from being friends with God. Hundreds of people saw Jesus before he went up to heaven.
And now we can call heaven home too and be with him when we die.
Jesus is alive!
And he's there in our hearts.
That's our story of Easter. But it's still not the end of the story.
God loves me.
And he loves you.
God loves everybody.
And he wants us to be his friends.
Well, we trust you all received something into your hearts from that clip. You know, as we get older, we can so easily complicate things without realising it. That's why we can so often learn more from the simplicity that children have. And I think that kids in that video have helped us to understand the good news of the gospel. And the outworking of that message is seen in the lives of everyday people like you and me who have accepted the new life that Jesus came to offer us. Which brings us nicely to one of our regular features called My Story. Each week, a member of the Rock Church compresses their life-transforming story into a 3-minute video. Now, without the resurrection of Christ, no one would have a story to tell. But thank God, Jesus did rise from the grave so that billions around the world can tell of their own account of being what the Bible calls born again. Here's Sarah with her story.
Hi everyone, I'm Sarah. I'm 26, mother of Rosie and lover of chocolate. I'm going to try and get my testimony in 3 minutes, so here we go. So my parents always took me to church growing up, even if it was only for 30 minutes so I could get to my football matches on time. Really bright, bubbly girl, loving life, and things only changed when I turned 16. I dropped out of sixth form, scraped through college, dropped out of uni, and I was more concerned with parties, drinking till I could forget the parties, and chasing after lads who only wanted one thing from me. That went on for 5 years, till January 2015, I moved to Hull to become a teaching assistant to get a fresh start. About a month or so living there, I found out I was 6 months pregnant, as you do, so I moved back home, had my beautiful daughter Rosie. I tried to force a relationship that really wasn't working, then did some things I wasn't proud of and got stuck in a really serious toxic relationship that just completely destroyed me. During that time, my parents paid for me to do a qualification to become a teaching assistant, and at the same time, I got diagnosed with depression. So it was a really dark time. I tried to force happiness, tried to force relationships, and it just never worked. I put myself out there and I'd still just get cheated on and heartbroken. Went out for a friend's birthday, went on a night out, drank a bit too much, got in some trouble and dislocated my arm. Walking into church the next morning, I just felt so shameful. So I quit drinking, wanted to be spirit-filled in a different way. And because I wasn't hungover in church, I was paying attention more to what people were saying and I was taking on board the advice and words people had for me. The amazing women at the Rock Church built me back up like kintsugi, which is a Japanese art of repairing broken pottery with silver and gold to make a new piece, and I just felt like a really positive woman of God. I tried twice to be a teaching assistant, several times in different relationships, but failed. Again, would still get cheated on. It just wasn't my time. And God really had to strip me back completely of all my false pretenses and ideas I had to rebuild me in the right place spiritually and emotionally. And then in late 2018, a lovely, lovely lady happened to join our church and offered me a job as a teaching assistant. So now I've got a really great job. I teach some awesome kids. I even met my absolute blessing of a partner through my job. And I could have only have dreamt about these things. And when I finally let go and let God and trusted in his timing, I got them. Growing up on Disney movies, I was heartbroken to discover that life isn't a fairy tale where a fairy godmother will wave her magic wand and your dreams will come true. You should have seen me when I found out I couldn't talk to animals and Prince Charming wouldn't sweep me off his feet onto his horse and ride into the sunset. It's taken me 26 years to where I've got to today. So if you're getting fed up or doubting or just not knowing where your life is going, trust in God. Let go of your ideas of what life is going to be. Trust in his timing, because I promise you, the plans he's got for you are far, far greater than anything any of us could have imagined.
Thank you, Sarah, for sharing your story. We hope and pray that it will encourage others to think about their lives and how the supernatural can collide with the natural. And through a simple act of faith, how the seemingly impossible can become a reality. Right now, we're going to get ready to hear Pastor Kate as she shares her Easter message to us adults. And in preparation for that, we're going to go over to Jim, who's going to lead us in a song of worship. We're going to sing, Oh Praise the Name. If you're not familiar with it, then the lyrics are going to come up at the bottom of the screen. The song relates to the story of Easter that we heard from the kids earlier on. So as we sing, let's recall again the amazing accounts recorded in the Bible about the life of Jesus Christ. Jim, over to you.
Good morning, church. Let's worship. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Blazing sun shall pierce the night. and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Let's sing that again. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Oh Lord our God.
Says, my king is a king of the Jews. He's a king of Israel. He's a king of righteousness. He's a king of the ages. He's a king of heaven. He's a king of glory. He's a king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's a key to knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. He's a gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your head. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Terror couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. Yeah.
Amazing. For those of you who tuned in last week, you may recall Ali talking about how we can know of people, but do we really know them? He mentioned knowing of the Queen. God bless her. Long live the Queen. I absolutely love our Queen. We know who the Queen is, but we don't really know her, right? Because there's a difference between knowing about a person and actually knowing a person. Ali also mentioned how long us two have known each other. And we're just coming up to our 24th wedding anniversary. So I'd say we know each other pretty well. We took our vows. We love each other. We've got each other's backs. We won't let anyone else say a bad word against us. We're tight. We do stuff and we talk about stuff in private that no one else will ever be privy to. We're intimate. We share secrets and we enjoy each other's company. Because to really, really know someone means developing a relationship with them. And you can only really do that by spending time with that person. So we get familiar, we get friendly, it gets personal. So on this Easter Sunday, I want to talk to you about a special friend of mine that I know really well, that I have spent lots of time developing our relationship, even though he was actually born over 2,000 years ago to a young teen virgin girl called Mary. My friend lived in poverty and obscurity, pretty much unheard of until he was 30. And as a newborn, he startled a king. In childhood, he puzzled the doctors, and in manhood, he ruled the course of nature, walked on the water as if it was a pavement, and told the sea to be still. He never wrote a book, but all the libraries in the world can't hold all the books that have been written about him. He never wrote a song, but more songs have been written about him than anybody else. He never founded a college, but all the schools put together can't boast of having as many students. The names of past proved statesmen and presidents and prime ministers have come and gone. The names of past scientists and philosophers and theologians have come and gone. But the name of my friend still continues to flourish. When he was 30, he became a minister, and for 3 years, he just went about doing good to everyone. He taught crowds of people, even though he had had hardly any teaching or training himself. And he spoke powerfully to people's hearts without the use of a classroom or with any letters after his name. And when he spoke, his style was unique. He brought a crystal clear message unlike any other teacher of his day. And he made sure everyone could understand him by using simple words and picturesque speech and vivid illustrations. The people who heard him were amazed by him and the authority that he carried. He taught how to turn away from bad lifestyles. He promised forgiveness. He proclaimed freedom. He pronounced blessings. He healed the sick, opened the eyes of the blind, cleansed lepers, made the lame walk, calmed the distressed, made the dumb talk and the deaf hear, and he raised the dead. He taught people how to pray. He called for obedience. He warned of judgment, and he extended an invitation for everyone to come to him. And then 3 years later, at the age of 33, he was falsely arrested, tried and found guilty. He was dragged before a criminal court and was physically assaulted for remaining silent when he was questioned. He was blindfolded and beaten up by the guards who mocked him, spat on him and punched him in the face. He was tried and condemned to a whipping. The guards stripped off his clothes and tied his hands to a post above his head. And then a soldier stepped forward with a whip and it had heavy leather thongs with lead balls attached. He was hit at full force again and again across his shoulders and back and legs, and the lead ripped through his skin, exposing his internal organs. And when the whipping was over, his skin was left hanging in ribbons, the entire back of his body an unrecognisable mass of torn and bleeding tissue. When they thought he was almost dead, they untied him, mocked him some more, and threw a robe across him. They forced a stick into his hand and wove together a crown of thorns that they pressed down hard onto his scalp, bringing massive bleeding. The mocking and punching continued, and they took the stick from his hand and hit him across the head again and again, driving the crown of thorns deeper into his scalp. And when they finally got bored, they tore the robe off his back, which was stuck to the clots of blood and serum in his wounds. And if you've ever had a bandage or a plaster ripped off an open wound, you'll be familiar with that kind of pain, but definitely nowhere near on this kind of level. And if that wasn't enough, my friend was led out to be crucified, carrying on his shredded back a T-shaped cross. But the weight of it got too much and the rough, splintered wood was grating against his raw flesh. So the soldiers grabbed a guy from the crowd and he carried it for him. At the end of the 650-yard journey, my friend had his clothes stripped off him again, all but a loincloth to maintain some form of modesty, and then his crucifixion began. He was thrown backwards with his shoulders against the wood and had nails driven between the small bones in his wrist, not through the palms. The palms would have caused the nails to strip out between the fingers because of the weight. A large, heavy nail was driven through my friend's wrist and deep into the wood, and then it was repeated on the other side. The cross was lifted into the ground and his feet were nailed to hold him there. The soldiers have crucified him, but he's not dead. So excruciating pain shot along his fingers and up his arms to explode in the brain. His body got heavy and cramps swept over his muscles so he couldn't push himself up to draw air in. All he could do was breathe out. And so carbon dioxide was building in his lungs, and then his chest filled with serum and began to compress his heart. About to die but dehydrated, he managed to gasp. He was thirsty. The soldiers tried giving him a sponge soaked in cheap, sour wine, but he refused it. And then he gave out a tortured whisper, but oh, what a powerful confession. It is finished. And with one last breath, his final words uttered were, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." My friend led a sinless life, but he was willing to die on a cross. He endured shame and suffered in agony, poured out his blood and died for a world full of sinners. And then his body was taken down and buried in a tomb. But that's not the end of the story. And this is why I love and celebrate Easter. You see, 3 days later, this sin-forgiving, miracle-working, father-pleasing, cross-enduring, death-defeating, devil-defying guy who turned water into wine, walked on water and raised his mate Lazarus from the dead, came back from the dead himself, fully resurrected. Herod couldn't destroy him, death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. So, let me introduce you to my friend, Jesus Christ. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the way, the truth and the life. He's the Word. He's a wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father and the Prince of Peace, the Resurrection and the Life, the Great I Am, the Light of the World and the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. He's seated at the right hand of the Father, loved by God, acknowledged by angels, adored by his followers. That's 2.5 billion of us currently on the planet, feared by devils, and today still well alive and kicking. So I wonder, do you know him? Because you can know all about him, but knowing about him and really knowing him are two totally different things. If you're old enough, you probably sang about him in school assemblies as a kid, and you know how to recite the Lord's Prayer. It's funny, isn't it, how you still say it the way you were taught it. Our Father who art in heaven. We don't even use words like art anymore, but that's how we know to recite it. Many of us have heard of the Ten Commandments and that we shouldn't do bad stuff that the Bible calls sin. And we've heard the Christmas story of his birth and the Easter story of his death and resurrection. Some of us view him as a guy up in heaven, just miles away from our daily struggles, untouchable and completely irrelevant to our lives today. Some of us turn to him when we're desperate. And some of us just aren't even sure if he's real. But I'm here this morning to tell you, I've been following my friend for 41 years and I know him. I know he's real. I know he's relevant. I know he's interested in every detail of your lives. And once you've met him, you can't forget him because he's magnetic. He'll leave a lasting impression on your mind. He'll change you from the inside out, and he'll affect your life in such a way that you find yourself wanting him to be a part of every area of your life. In the words of Dr. Lockridge, who we've already heard just earlier, he's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. You can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Oh, I know he's real, because I've heard him speak to me. I've experienced him on countless occasions, undeniably and completely miraculously. He's revealed himself to me in so many different ways. I know him as my saviour, because when I was lost and in a dark place, he came looking for me, and he completely turned my world upside down. I was messed up, doing a whole load of stuff that wasn't good for me, or anybody else for that matter. I was racked with guilt and shame, and he just looked straight past all of it and love me. I know him as my healer. He's touched pain in my body and completely set me free from it. I've known him as my provider because he's never let me down. Financially, he's always come through for me in debt, in times of need, in seasons of lack. He's always seen us through. I know him as my example because he points me in the right direction. And his word, the Bible, it just lights a way forward for me and shows me how to live my life the way he did. I've known him as my comforter. He has got me through some of the most hideous situations in my life. I've known him as my peace. When I've been scared and stressed and anxious, a peace has enveloped me that the world will never understand, and I cannot even begin to explain it to you. I've experienced his forgiveness on so many occasions. I can't even add them all up. When I mess up, when I say sorry, he not only takes my sin away, but he tells me he doesn't even know what I'm feeling bad about anymore. Why? Because he chooses to forget. Because every sin I ever committed was taken and dealt with when he hung on that cross 2,000 years ago and shed his blood for my freedom. And knowing him the way I do, it makes me do things a little different. I don't want to go back to my old way of life. I can't go back to the way that I used to live because it makes me feel uncomfortable. I don't want anything to do with my old way of life. And it's funny that, because the reason so many people don't give their lives over to it is because they don't want to give up their lifestyles. And yet the reality is, when you really know him, you can't wait to give your old lifestyle away. I find myself wanting to be around my church family. I don't need to be asked to come to church. I can't wait to get to church. I don't need to be told to get to a monthly prayer meeting. I can't wait to get in the presence of God. Because when you really know Jesus, you want to talk to him. And you want to talk about him. You want to share him with others. Tell him how he's touched and affected your life. You can't help yourself from saying, you're never going to guess what he did for me this week. When good things happen to me, no matter who or where they might come from, I know it's him. Because nobody can bless you like Jesus. His blessings are patented. No matter how many people try and take the credit for the good things that happened to me, I know it's Jesus. He is an absolute legend. He's my absolute hero. I love everything about him. And I know him because I spent countless hours with him, and not one of them was a chore. I've loved every minute of the time that I've spent with him. And he is waiting today to spend some time with you. He's just waiting for you to ask him to be a part of your life. So I wonder today, do you know him? Do you belong to him? Do you want to know him? The gospel message, it just means good news. Pure and simple, it's this. Jesus came to this earth to die for our sins. He was buried, and on the third day he was raised to life so that we could have a personal relationship with him. Can I urge you today to say no to the pull of the world and yes to the man who can save you and set you free, cleanse you from all the rubbish in your life and write your name in his book to give you entrance into heaven one day. I know heaven sounds like a long way off, but you know, with the way things stand right now with this COVID-19 pandemic, none of us really know what our tomorrows hold, for us or for anyone else. We don't know what it's going to look like. For all we know, today could be our last day on the planet. So let me ask you this. If you were to die today and you stood before God and he said to you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? You might say, I'm a good person, I give to charity, I've helped a few people in my time. But you know, if you say that, it won't cut it. Because the only way to heaven is to believe in your heart and to confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. He's the one who died for us and rose again. I don't know where you're at today and how you're feeling about this message. But I do know this. Jesus died for you. He went to the cross willingly for you. He could have come down off it, but he chose to stay there. And if you were the only person left on the planet, he'd have still have hung there for you. Every sin any of us has ever committed was nailed to that cross with him. And something called the great exchange took place at that moment. As he's hung there, taking all our sin and shame and filthiness and messes, at the same time as he was taking all that, he was giving us something. He was giving us himself, his righteousness, his right standing, his goodness. And he declares us 100% right before God. So you don't need to worry about your past. It's gone, it's done, it's sorted. The focus now is on the fact that Jesus conquered Satan, death and the tomb. And he came that you can have life and life in all its fullness. He holds the answer to any question you've ever had. And he's the best thing that could ever happen to you. The most important decision you can ever make is to get to know him. You see, you can know of him in your head, or you can really know him by opening up your heart. So I'll ask again, I wonder, do you know him?
set up your will for the joy to come. You embrace the cross, taking all its pain, so I could walk away free and unashamed. I owe my life to you, my Savior. I owe it all to you alone. Your sacrifice has won my freedom. I was bought by Jesus' blood. Risen from the grave, seated now on high, over all you reign, all power in your hand. Eternity will sing of your holy name, King of all the earth, in majesty to come. I am Savior, I owe it all to you alone. Your sacrifice has won my freedom. I was bought by Jesus' blood. You paid it all. I stand before the throne of grace, and wonder fills my heart, your majesty revealed. I will bow my knee and join with angels' song. Worthy is the Lamb, all praise to you alone. Sacrifice has won my freedom. I was bought by Jesus' blood. I owe my life to you, my Savior. I owe it all to you alone. Your sacrifice has won my freedom. My Savior, I owe it all to you alone. Your sacrifice has won my freedom. I was bought by Jesus' blood.
Jim, thank you very much for leading us in worship today again. Always amazing to have you on the guitar.
Yay.
And Kate, outstanding message again. Always great to focus in on the true reason for the season.
Indeed.
So I think it'd be good for you to pray for us close out this live stream this morning. That would be fantastic.
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's pray.
Yeah. Yeah, Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for sending your son. Thank you for Easter Sunday. Thank you that we get to celebrate this day, the day that you rose from the grave, and we get to do it with billions of Christians all over the planet. And Lord, I just pray for everybody that is tuned in today or may watch this on catch-up, Lord, that they will know that they have spent time in your presence, Lord. And I just pray you'll send us into our weekend now, into this bank holiday, that we'll be blessed, that we will be able to spend time with our family, Lord, and enjoy the weather and just enjoy you. In Jesus' name.
Yes. Amen. Amen and amen. So we are not going to do a continuation of our live stream. No chat on the sofa. No, we're going to release you into the garden, into the wonderful sunshine. I know. Woo. Can you smell some barbecues going?
Mm.
Yeah. So
only in your own houses, though.
Absolutely. Enjoy that. Enjoy yourselves. Enjoy each other's company. If you are isolating alone, our prayers are fully with you.
Absolutely.
And we want to end our session today, our time with you, with a little promo to talk about Alpha.
Yeah.
We're taking Alpha online. We've been digging deep into how to transfer this from the physical location we had planned. And we're really excited about the opportunities that this brings into a wider scope and catchment of people. Yeah. So we would love you to consider being part of Alpha. And if you're already a follower of Christ, then we want to encourage you to invite people along. The link's coming at the end of this short promo video. Have a look on there. Make sure you get your friends and family booked in. This is going to be great.
Yeah.
Watch this.
Every day we ask so many questions. What should I wear? What's the weather going to be like? How am I going to fit everything in? But then there are those bigger questions, like why am I here? Where am I heading? Is there more to life than this?
I had arrived at an answer to the most important issue that we humans ever deal with. Is there a God? And I had arrived there without ever really looking at the evidence. And I was supposed to be a scientist.
At 28, I had gotten many of the things that I thought I wanted. You know, my girlfriend was on the cover of magazines, I had a Beamer, and I was so unhappy. It was a realization maybe that I would never find happiness where I was looking for it.
I think for so many years, you know, I always just strive to be strong in myself. All I needed was me and my buddies and, you know, we'd be like invincible. But the truth is, none of us are.
I found purpose, I found meaning, I found hope. God took something so broken and made it a beautiful art piece.
Alpha is a place where you can be yourself. You can say what you think and challenge everything. No question is too complex or too simple. And what your point of view is as important as anyone else's.
We are going on a journey together, an adventure to explore the questions of life, faith, and meaning.